What's up everyone, Matt here with the Maya Learning Channel, and today you might notice something a little different. That's right, I do indeed have a face. So what's the occasion for the big reveal? Well, demystifying my appearance seemed appropriate given that today I wanted to demystify something else. A certain buzzword that has the potential to completely revolutionize the filmmaking industry. And that buzzword is...
USD. Using USD. USD. USD.
But what exactly is USD and why should you care? Well, that's exactly what we're here to find out today. Now, if you're an industry professional or even just an enthusiast, you may have already heard the term USD being thrown around. In fact, if you've been employed by or done contract work for a major VFX studio lately, you may have even run into it. At first, it might appear to just be another way to store data, like Maya files, Max files, FBX files, and so on, and in a way it is. But what makes USD special is the way it stores scene information. The clue is in the title itself, which stands for Universal Scene Description. In other words, rather than storing a scene as a single, bloated, software-specific scene file with everything in it, it instead describes how to assemble the scene from a bunch of smaller files. By breaking things down into more manageable chunks like this, you get vastly improved scene performance, while giving artists the ability to load only what they need when they need it, as well as the ability to express different opinions on various parts of those descriptions. You see, gone are the days when a single VFX house, even ones as big as ILM or Weta, can take on the bulk of the responsibility in a large production, while supported by a handful of smaller studios. Nowadays, movies are so big that they often need 4, 5, even 6 major houses handling point, usually with a small army of support studios backing them up. And even within those studios, there are more departments using more software packages than ever before. And with each of those software packages speaking a different language while trying to pass the same data around, is it any wonder that a universal scene description has suddenly become the holy grail? In fact, solving that problem is exactly the reason that Pixar, yes, that Pixar, began developing this standard while working on Brave way back in 2010. And it's the reason they're now sharing it with every other studio out there, because it's in everyone's best interest to make data exchange as painless as possible. Basically, what I'm saying is that if you ever want to do work for one of these FX houses in the future, you're going to likely run into USD sooner or later. And that means you need to know how to work with USD data. But how does it work exactly? Well, everything in USD starts with a primitive, or a prim. Now, these aren't just your run-of-the-mill Maya primitives, like cubes and spheres. No, a USD primitive can be as basic or complex as you like. The only stipulation is that a prim can't be broken down any further. In other words, a prim is the smallest possible unit in USD. How you decide what a smallest unit consists of is completely up to you. Maybe something like this kettle is the smallest unit. Or maybe the individual pieces that make it up are a single unit. It's really up to you. Either way, once you've decided what a prim is, you can then compose them into sets of prims to make more and more complex objects. So here we have Pixar's own test kitchen scene that they released with USD, loaded into Maya. I put a link to it in the description below. If I select this USD kettle, you can see that the artist here went with the latter route regarding their prim design. Its individual pieces are each considered a prim. And unlike a Maya polygon equivalent, those prims can't be further broken down into vertices, edges, or faces. This distinction between USD data and Maya data is important. Even though these two objects look identical, they play by a different set of rules as we just saw. The easiest way to tell the difference is in the outliner by turning on shapes. Anything with these diamond-shaped icons is native USD data. So typically what you do is model an object in Maya just like normal, then instead of saving a Maya file, you'll instead export to .usd. This breaks down your object hierarchy into a bunch of prim compositions. Notice here all the different compositions saved as individual USD files. This means that as an artist, you'll want to make sure that the structure of your Maya scene reflects the prims that you, or more likely the studio you're working for, wants before you export. Whether that means breaking down the object like this kettle, or leaving it as a single mesh like this mug. And this applies to more than just polygon objects. A prim can be anything from a light to an effect or even a shader. Don't worry though, if you ever need to edit your USD data again, you can easily do that by right-clicking it, then making your edits to the Maya version, then send those edits back to the USD version once you're done. Finally, it's important to note that a prim can have alternate versions assigned to it called variants. Think different styles of the same thing. Prims with variants will be denoted by a small V in the corner of their outliner icon. So, working in USD is really just about shifting your mindset a bit. As an artist, it's your job to A, plan ahead about how you can break down your traditionally complex structures, like a model, into prims, or B, make sure that your contribution adheres to the criteria handed down by your employer. This way, you can ensure that your cog will fit into the rest of the pipeline. Speaking of that though, how does the rest of the pipeline work in USD? Well, as I said before, a USD scene doesn't consist of a single flat file with everything in it. Instead, it sets something called a stage that describes how to assemble the scene together. Now, it's important to note that one of the biggest strengths of USD is its open-endedness. Any studio can choose to assemble a film or game however they want. But what I'm about to show you is the most common setup, the way that Pixar itself uses USD. So here we start at the bottom with a bunch of individual USD assets. At this point, someone from the layout department needs to come along and assemble them on stage into a starting scene. Once the starting scene is complete, others in that department may layer on opinions on top of that scene. Note how these layers are hierarchical. Those higher up represent stronger opinions that override lower opinions. Notice that I said override and not overwrite, though. That's because, thanks to the way layers are stored as .usd files themselves, a higher opinion will never completely obliterate anything in a lower one. Reviving data from a lower opinion is as easy as muting the one above it. So, back in Maya, we can see a practical example of this in the USD layer editor. By activating these layers one at a time, you can see the buildup of different artists' opinions on the scene. And if I'm a director and I don't like an opinion, it's easy to mute it. So now you're hopefully getting an idea of how powerful it can be to work in layers and opinions like this. It's what's called non-destructive editing, and if you've ever accidentally overwritten a scene file that you needed again later, you can probably see why it's such a big deal. And everything I showed you is just in the layout department. If I zoom out here, you can see that this pattern continues up through other departments too, like animation, effects, and lighting, which work on their own layers, building up the foundation we established with layout. Now you can see that we have one large layer per department, made up of smaller sublayers for the artists within those departments. And just like the layout sublayer we just looked at, each of these individuals in each of these departments can override things done by previous departments. So if I'm in the FX department, and I don't necessarily care about the changes made by the animation department, I can just mute them. But the same is true lower down the chain too. If I'm in layout and I want to see what the current scene lighting looks like because it's going to affect where I place an object, I can do that just as easily. And all this is made possible because everyone is working from one central set of data, rather than each of them having their own version of the scene. So hopefully now you have a better idea of what USD is and what it can do for you. If you want to learn more about USD, including some of the more advanced topics I wasn't able to get to in this video, I've included some helpful links and other resources in the description below. And for more on USD, make sure to subscribe to the Maya Learning Channel. I plan to make a few more videos detailing the process of using USD specifically in Maya. See you later!